Number 867 for our next hymn. 867, 867, the old account was settled.
I hope you can say that.
Amen. Amen. Open us a Sunday morning with a word of prayer.
Our Heavenly Father, it is amazing to us that you could do such a thing as sending your Son to die for our sins so that we might be set free, that we might be forgiven. Lord, when we stop and think of the sins that we have committed, the sins that are involved in this world, what an amazing gift you have given to those who would receive it. And Father, we pray that everyone here today might have a receptive heart towards those things. If they have not received Christ as their Savior, that they do so today. And Father, for those of us who have received Christ, what a blessing it is What a blessing it is to be together with God's people in a gathering like this, and to be able to sing songs of Zion, to sing about our Savior.
Thank you, Lord.
And to sing about your love towards us. And we pray, Father, you'll be blessing us this day, this year, as long as Jesus tarries. And Father, that you'll bless the pastor as he preaches today, that we might be encouraged in our hearts to be living for our Savior. For it is in his name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. You may be seated. And I remind everybody at this time, if you do have a cell phone on your person, if you just check that, please make sure that it is off. And we appreciate that. I'm going to check mine to make sure that it is off. It would be very embarrassing if the guy who gave the announcements phone went off, wouldn't it? Okay, 100% sure on that one. It's good to see everybody here this morning. And I would like to remind everybody that if you've not been to a Sunday evening service, come on out and join us, because we're getting together tonight, this evening at 6 o'clock. And it's great to get, again, together with the saints and hear more from the Word of God. And then Monday comes. You got to have some ammo, right? And you want to be here for that, okay? Join us this evening. Tuesday evening, prayer and fasting at 6 p.m., as we have that every Tuesday evening. And as we talk about getting together with the saints, sometimes we hear people talk, and we're here this evening or this morning. And you know what I hear when people talk? There's a prayer. There's a prayer. There's a prayer request. And so, you know, maybe you think I'm a little twisted that way, but that's prayer fodder, okay? People talk. They have needs. Yeah, I'm going through this. That's a prayer. And so join us Tuesday evening for prayer and fasting. Then we have Wednesday evening Bible study and prayer to follow as well on Wednesday evening. Please come out as we're going through the book of Judges. Powerful. All these books that we go on. The pastor's been doing a great job. Judges, Joshua, and boy, I tell you, talk about growth. That has been in my life from that. So come on out and join us. Now, this Friday evening, everybody know what's going on? We got the spaghetti dinner this Friday. So, you know what? With every endeavor we have here, we need what? Some help. So we're asking for some volunteers to help us with this, okay? Margie and I will be here on Friday. If we're eating at 6, we need to be here at 3 o'clock to get everything prepped, okay? It takes some time to get that done, okay? There's a lot of work to be done. If you want to volunteer and help us on Friday, we're going to be here at 3 o'clock. Please see me or Margie after the service. We need some helping hands here, okay? And that starts at 6 o'clock. We will be serving spaghetti until whenever, okay? We'll have plenty. And there is a sign-up sheet if you intend to bring something. If you cannot bring, please come out anyway. We'll have plenty. Brother Jack Britt will be here with his wife, Lyle, and looking forward to that. Saturday morning, we'll be having prayer here at 10 a.m., and always looking for more prayer ears for the Saturday morning prayer team, okay? And then Friday evening, February 11th, our winter picnic, our annual winter picnic, Brother Tony Saxon will be joining us. Please pray for that, and please bring people out to the spaghetti dinner. Don't be afraid to invite. Geez, I have a friend. Bring them out, okay? They're not saved. Bring them out. They need to hear the gospel. Get around some saints. See how we operate here. So with that, I'd like to have our ushers please come forward for the presentation of tithes and offerings this morning. Brother Gary, if you'll please pray over the tithes and offerings for us.
Heavenly Father, thank you, dear Lord, for waking us up this morning, dear Lord, allowing us to give you praise, dear Lord. And I pray, dear Lord, that our hearts and our minds would just focus on you, dear Lord, in these times, dear Lord, as we look forward to seeing you come. So with that, Father, I just ask you that our hearts and our spirits would be focused on the preaching, dear Lord, and that we would be receptive, dear Lord, of the truth that comes from your word, dear Lord. And I ask you, dear Lord, that you would bless this offering, dear Lord, as we give back, that you may get the honor and glory for it. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
It's a new one for us. It's called, "I Can't Even Walk Without Holding Your Hand." It is very applicable to our Christian life with our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Please turn with me to hymn number 145 in our hymnals. Hymn number 145. 145, "Burdens Are Lifted at Calvary."
Is very near.
He's got a song for us. I want you to hear. I hope it'll be a blessing. It's about what happens when you take God out of the equation. Amen. All right, sing it out. Sing it out. Let it rip. Okay.
Yes, sir. He's got to get the words back. If it will load.
Sorry.
If it will load.
It'll load. Should load, right?
Here they are.
Yeah.
Yes. This is a song by a group called Wilburn and Wilburn. It's You Asked Him to Leave. Special report on the 6 o'clock news. Another shooting in another school. 6 rounds fired, 3 lives lost. Gun in the wrong hands, oh what a cost. Old town gathers as questions fly. Why God allow 3 children to die? Then old Mr. Carter stepped forward and said, seems you've forgotten just what you did. God wasn't allowed in your school today, but you wanted it that way. Didn't you? God is not the one to blame. He didn't bring your pain. I say to you, He didn't cause this tragedy. He wasn't there. Remember, you asked Him to leave. Last night I had a terrible dream. There was violence and anger in the streets. No houses of prayer, no peace, no rest. I messed up on the word, sorry. No way to escape a world in distress. No houses of prayer, no peace, no rest. And those that are among us who want God gone stood in confusion wondering what went wrong. With their face in their hands, not sure what was next, I looked in their eyes and said, what'd you expect? God wasn't allowed in your world today, but you wanted it that way, didn't you? God is not the one to blame. He didn't bring your pain, I say to you. He didn't cause this tragedy. He wasn't there. No, remember you asked him to leave. Oh, he wasn't there. Remember you asked him to leave.
Solve a lot of problems if we just plugged them back into the equation. Right? Imagine the originator of mathematics not being a part of the equation. Isn't that something?
Absolutely.
And what a mistake. The world needs to get back to learn how to trust God. Amen. We're back in Luke chapter 23. I'm going to ask you if you'd turn there. Luke chapter 23 and John chapter 19. Luke chapter 23, John chapter 19. Oh, you know what? While you're turning there, I forgot to mention, we're having that meeting after the service for all those that read their Bible through, okay? So we're talking about having that meeting right after church. If you read your Bible through in a year, right? How many are going to be at that meeting? I need to know, okay? So we got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. Let's do it again, okay? Because I don't know if I can. We're in the double digits. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. Okay, I think. So 11 or 12. How many chairs are in the back there, Brother John?
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8,
9, 10, 11. Okay, so why don't we meet after service? We'll meet in the back of the auditorium, okay? And we'll discuss, you know, where we're going to go, when we're going to go, that whole thing. Now, of course, we're talking about the folks whose names were on the list. And you've put money in. You put money in the till every time you read one of the books of the Bible. You put money in so that we can go out to dinner afterwards. So if you didn't put any money in, okay, you're disqualified. Okay, we really do appreciate the fact that you read your Bible through in a year. That's a blessing. But you're not getting a free meal out of the deal. You had to put your money in order to go out with us, okay? So that's one of those stipulations. Okay, so Luke chapter 23, John 19. And this is one of those passages, it's like, Lord, how in the world am I going to present this? And it's not a preaching message. But Sunday morning, I'm supposed to be preaching and preaching the gospel. But this is not a preaching message. And so you know what? It's the Word of God, so it's okay. So if it comes across as more of a teaching instead of a preaching, then you know why. So we're in Luke chapter 23, and hold your finger or your bulletin or whatever you got in John 19. We're going to be flip-flopping back and forth. So don't lose your place there and try to stay with me. Look at verse 47. Jesus has now given up the ghost, okay? He's hanging on the cross, and he's bled out. He's bled out. And in verse 47, the Bible says, "Now when the centurion saw what was done, he glorified God, saying, certainly this was a righteous man." Amen. And all the people came together to that sight, beholding the things which were done, smote their breasts and returned. And all his acquaintance and the women that followed him from Galilee stood afar off, beholding these things.
And behold, there was a man named Joseph, a counselor, and he was a good man and a just. The same had not consented to the counsel and deed of them. He was of Arimathea, a city of the Jews, who also himself waited for the kingdom of God. This man went unto Pilate and begged the body of Jesus, and he took it down. I want you to try to visualize that. And he took it down and wrapped it in linen and laid it in a sepulcher that was hewn in stone, wherein never man before was laid. And that day was the preparation, and the Sabbath drew on. And the women also, which came with him from Galilee, followed after and beheld the sepulcher and how his body was laid. And they returned and prepared spices and ointments and rested the Sabbath day according to the commandment. It's quite a mouthful there. Before I go any further, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Amen. Let's bow our heads. Father, I'm grateful for the Word of God. Lord, I'm grateful for the events that it portrays to us. And Lord, here we're seeing some people that cared about the Lord Jesus Christ and had an understanding of what was going on. And when everyone else was turned to walk away, someone was turning toward the Lord and taking care of business. Thank you for Joseph. Lord, I'm asking that you would help us to paint this picture on the canvas of our minds this morning and see what we can see, how we line up with our thinking, with our thoughts, with our traditions, with the way we conduct ourselves on a daily and annual basis. Help us, Lord. We're asking these things in Jesus' name. Amen. I just, you know, I'm not trying to be gross, okay? I'm looking out here, and I realize that there's probably not more than one or two people that have ever killed a deer and then had to hang it up and allow it to bleed out and then take care of it afterwards, weighing however much it weighed, skin on. It's Sunday morning. How many of you have ever gutted a deer? One, two people beside myself. So you got an idea what I'm talking about. And that's what was going through my mind when I was just reading this. Now, I remember the weight of the body, right? And it's like a deer is about as heavy as a human being. And so I'm going through that while I'm reading this. I'm thinking, Joseph, I've kind of gone through that a little bit, not with a human. But I have an idea. I mean, I can relate a little bit. The Bible says here that the centurion saw what was done and he glorified God, saying, certainly this was a righteous man. I have a hard time reading that, and I'm sorry, I'm trying not to interject any humor, but to me it's humorous. How many have ever seen the movie The Greatest Story Ever Told? Right? John Wayne plays the centurion. The dumbest line I ever heard from John Wayne, saying it in true John Wayne fashion. He said, truly, this man was the Son of God. It was like so out of character for him. It's almost as bad as listening to Johnny Cash sing The Little Drummer Boy. It's right up there, the two of those things, I'm telling you. But what I'm trying to say is this: he saw what was done and he glorified God, saying, certainly this was a righteous man. The centurion was yet another eyewitness, another eyewitness to the crucifixion of the historical figure of Jesus Christ. If someone ever tries to tell you that Jesus is just a legend, they're ignorant. There is no other word for it. They're just ignorant. They don't know. He also gave an eyewitness testimony as to the sinless nature of Jesus. I wonder how dangerous it was for him to make that statement. People hearing him making that statement. What are you trying to say there? You're a Gentile. You're a Roman soldier. You're supposed to be for whatever takes place here. You're supposed to be all for it. You're a centurion. You're supposed to be an example. Yeah, well, this guy had a sinless nature. He was righteous. You know what that's saying? He's innocent. In essence, he was proclaiming his innocency, wasn't he? And the Bible says he glorified God, leading me, maybe, I don't know about you, but it leads me to believe that as a Gentile, he became a believer. And as a result of what he witnessed. And if that were the case, then that makes two souls, at least that we know of, that were saved right then and there as a result of Jesus' death. Two souls, right then and there. The thief on the cross and the centurion. It's hard to glorify God if you're not a believer and you're proclaiming the righteousness of Jesus Christ. That's tough. I'm saying even the death of Jesus Christ is our example, okay? I'm just teaching this morning. As an example, Jesus, we're disciples. That means we're followers of Jesus Christ. And at the death of Jesus Christ, people are getting saved. It's not uncommon. Well, I guess, Ruth, maybe it is uncommon. I don't know. I want to say that it's not uncommon for someone to give the gospel out at a funeral. And I'm just looking at you and I'm remembering Basil. And I'm remembering the woman from Canada that was sitting in the back there and that she told you how uncommon it was to actually be at a funeral and how grateful she was that the gospel went out and an invitation was there at a funeral and how rare it is. And that was how many years ago? It was many years ago. I'm saying I use funerals and memorial services as an opportunity to draw souls to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. Jesus did it. And people say, well, people don't want to be reminded of heaven and hell at a time like this. Really? Yeah. Really? That's when they're the most tender. I want to, listen, whenever, if I check out, you know, if there's any of you left here, still after I check out, and we have if my funeral is here, I want to go on record as saying, I want the gospel given out. I want somebody to give the gospel out. Be a gospel and show people how to be saved. Explain to people how to be saved. And ask them to bow their heads and ask them to raise their hand if they prayed and ask the Lord to save them. And give an invitation. Amen?
Amen.
It's biblical as far as I can tell.
Amen.
I want to see souls. I would love to see souls saved as a result of my death.
Amen.
Right? My life might be the only thing that keep people from God. Maybe once I check out, maybe it's like, okay, if he's as long as he's out of the way, I'll come to Christ. I don't know. I'm saying this. I'm saying you could be saved for 5, 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60 years or more, having never won a soul to Christ. Having never won a soul. Sad. Sad testimony. Anyone saved that long, having never led a soul to Christ. But even with that in mind, if someone were saved at your funeral, as a result of your funeral, you realize you could inherit a soul winner's crown when you get into glory. Wouldn't that be something?
Yes.
Wouldn't it be something to have that soul winner's crown? What a blessing. Well, there was a man in verse 50. Behold, there was a man named Joseph. He's a counselor, and he was a good man and a just. The same had not consented to the counsel and deed of them. He was of Arimathea, a city of the Jews, who also himself waited for the kingdom of God. He's a believer, isn't he? Here's a Jew. He's a counselor. In John chapter 19, he's referred to as Joseph of Arimathea. And again, he's a counselor. In other words, he sat on the Sanhedrin. That's what that means. When it's saying there in verse 51, the same had not consented to the council. You know why he didn't consent? Because he was there, and he was probably asked for his consent, and he didn't give it. But they found Jesus guilty anyway. I'm saying he didn't agree with the council. In fact, over there in John 19, if you take a look at verse 38, I want to read that to you real quick. The Bible says, after this, Joseph of Arimathea, being a disciple of Jesus. Now, he sat on the Sanhedrin, right? But secretly, he was a secret disciple. For fear of the Jews, besought Pilate that he might take away the body of Jesus. And Pilate gave him leave. He came, therefore, and took the body of Jesus. And if you look at verse 39, you'll see that Nicodemus was also involved at this point. Remember, Nicodemus was also a Pharisee, wasn't he? He was the same Nicodemus that came to Jesus by night, back in John chapter 3. So you got these two members of the Sanhedrin that did not consent. When we're reading Luke, we're only told about Joseph, but in John, we're told about the both of them. I don't know if that was good English. But Nicodemus, it says there in John 19 that he brought a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 100-pound weight. I looked that up to see if a Jewish 100-pound weight, how that fared to our American pounds, and basically the 100-pound weight they're talking about would be about 75 pounds of, for, you know, 75 pounds of aloe. That's a lot of spice, right? That's a lot. And he worked with Joseph to prepare the body of Jesus for burial. And the Bible says they're waiting for the kingdom of God that Jesus talked about. And listen, they were secret disciples. They didn't want the Sanhedrin to know. I think the Sanhedrin knows now. Now that they went and got the body and pulled the body down off the cross, it's like, isn't that somebody else's job? What are you guys doing it for? I'll bet you they took some heat for that. I'm saying Joseph got permission from Pilate, took the body down. He and Nicodemus prepared the body with myrrh and aloes, and they wrapped him in linen, okay? Brings us to an interesting topic. That's the burial procedure. And I'm saying, Jesus is dead. Now, this is profound. But when you're dead, your heart's not beating anymore. And when your heart's not beating anymore, you're done bleeding because there's no pump to pump the blood, okay? The bleeding has stopped. And listen, and thank God for that, because now our sins have been cleansed.
Amen.
Can I get racial here for a minute? Is that okay? Doesn't matter. I'm going to do it anyway. I always wonder when we're singing Power in the Blood, and we sing it at the prisons whenever we're let back in there. We're singing Power of the Blood, and it's a, would you be whiter, much whiter than snow? And it's like, I always, when I'm singing that in the prisons, I'm always wondering, it's like, I wonder how the black people feel about it. But it's obvious that they're not talking about their skin color. They're talking about their sin and their spiritual issue. Is there anybody here that's white as snow? I mean, Max comes close, but... There's not a person in this room that's white as snow, right? That's not a racial issue. But I had to be racial in order to bring that out. Carlos, you remind me of a Puerto Rican Abraham Lincoln, I'm telling you. Yeah, four score, you can give the Gettysburg Address.
George Steinberg.
Yeah. Oh my. I'm just off top dead center, okay? I have a warped sense of humor. I'm not right in the head, okay? That's the only amen I've ever gotten out of you. I'm telling you. Let's get serious. Can we get serious? I'm saying the blood of Jesus has stopped flowing now, and my sins are cleansed. Your sins, if you've placed your faith and trust in Jesus Christ, your sins have been forgiven. No more blood. It's gone. The blood's been wiped off his body for the most part. Between Joseph and Nicodemus, they wiped the body down. And then they packed that 75 pounds of spices around the body to work its way into a body, marinated, if you will. I don't know another word for it. But they packed those spices around that body to preserve that body, and then they wrapped that body in linen. Interesting to note that the head of the Lord Jesus was wrapped separately from his body. You find that in John chapter 20, as long as you're there in John. Look at verse 6 of chapter 20 there. It's talking about after the resurrection, okay? After the burial, after the death, after the burial, after the 3 days, 3 nights, after the resurrection. The Bible says, "Then cometh Simon Peter following him, and went into the sepulchre, and seeth the linen clothes lie, and the napkin that was about his head not lying with the linen clothes." Were the linens that Jesus was wrapped in wrapped around his head? No. Okay. But they were the napkin that was about his head not lying with the linen clothes, but wrapped together in a place by itself. You see that? Why is that important? Well, I'm saying this, that with the amount of spices that were used, I don't know if you can, and I don't know what people here can imagine, okay? I burn coal at my house. Some of you have dogs, and maybe you buy a big bag of dog food. I have coal, and the coal comes in 40-pound bags. Two 40-pound bags is a lot of weight, okay? And that's about how much spices, I mean, my wife and daughter, if they're bringing in a bag of coal, they're using two hands and they're going like this to bring the 40-pound bag, okay? This is about twice that. This is a lot of spice. And it's packed around Jesus, and then he's wrapped in it. I'm saying because of the amount of spices, there's very little likelihood that you're going to see an imprint of the body on a linen sheet that hasn't been bleeding. And his head is wrapped separately. So what is the chance that you're going to have a linen with the outline of his body on one sheet of linen when his head's wrapped separately? That's a magic act right there. I don't know what the so-called sacred shroud of Turin is, but I know what it's not. I know what it's not. It's not the linen that they wrapped Jesus in, because the linen they wrapped him in was in two pieces, not one. Welcome to Evangelical Baptist Church, amen? Like, it's, I don't know how to respond when everybody's just like, huh, do you know how much money I've given to that thing to preserve? I've given to that memorial. It's like, what is he saying? That's it, I'm not coming back here anymore. Turin. Wasn't he a dwarf?
Yeah.
Seems like he should have been a dwarf. Sounds like a dwarf's name. The sepulchre. Back to Luke chapter 23, verse 53. The Bible says he took it down, talking about the body of Jesus, okay, and wrapped it in linen and laid it in a sepulchre that was hewn in stone, wherein never man before was laid. According to Matthew chapter 7, that sepulchre was actually Joseph's tomb. It was Joseph's. Gave his own tomb. Look back in John chapter 19. Like I said, this is more of a teaching thing. We're going back. We're comparing scripture with scripture, okay? John 19, look at verse 41. Bible says, now in the place where he was crucified, there was a garden. And in the garden, a new sepulchre, wherein was never man yet laid. There laid they Jesus, therefore, because of the Jews' preparation day, for the sepulchre was nigh at hand. Well, what that's saying basically is that the tomb is right there at the at this garden, and this garden is right adjacent to where Jesus was crucified. And Joseph and Nicodemus, they're anxious to get the Lord's body in that tomb before 6 o'clock, right? They got to get in there before 6 o'clock because that's when the day changes to the next day in Jewish time, okay? And it was the Jews' preparation day. What were they preparing for? What were they preparing for?
Passover,
thank you. It's important that we understand that. And so they're anxious to get the body in the tomb before 6 o'clock. It's the Jewish preparation day. They're preparing for the Passover. At 6 p.m., the Jews, 6 p.m., I'm sure they didn't have atomic clocks. But the Jews would begin the Passover supper. And you know what? And it's hard sometimes because there's times I'm not trying to be a smart aleck. And I'm not trying to be funny, but I mean, it's like I'm just trying to, I want you to know that I understand they're not all looking at their wristwatches. Their cell phones aren't beeping. Okay, tell them that it's time to start the Passover. But that brings up another point now, doesn't it? We just blew the sacred. See, if you want to make something sound really important and expensive and make people want to give their money, you put two words in front of it, sacred or holy. And then all of a sudden it becomes this mystical thing and it's worth giving your money to. That sacred shroud of Turin. Okay? Oversized dwarf. Now we're getting on to something else here, and I know I'm going to get a lot of people mad at me for this, okay? But I'm going to say it anyway. Another interesting point. All Greek Orthodox, all Protestants claim that Jesus was crucified on Good Friday, right? Good Friday, based on the Sabbath that's mentioned there in verse 54. But let me just say this, it's a gross error. It's a gross error. And it's insulting to the Word of God and to the Holy Ghost of God. All right? You can't get 3 days and 3 nights if you're putting somebody in the grave Friday night and they're gone first thing Sunday morning. You can't get 3 days and 3 nights out of that. Well, you got Friday and then you got Saturday, you got Sunday. By the time they're putting him in the grave, it's the end of Friday's over with. Now you got Saturday and Sunday morning, first thing, he's gone. So basically, that leaves you Saturday. Matthew chapter 12. You can turn there if you want. You don't have to, but just Jesus Christ himself. When Jesus says something, boy, we ought to take note. And Jesus said, Matthew, in Matthew 12, verse 40, he said, for as Jonas, talking about Jonah, was 3 days and three nights in the whale's belly, so shall the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. How many days and how many nights was Jesus in the heart of the earth? 3 days and three nights, right? And again, you can't get 3 days and three nights from Friday night to Sunday morning. It's impossible. Maybe the new math or something that they're teaching the kids now, I don't know. But for 2,000 years, it's been the wrong answer. The nights begin at 6 p.m. and they run until 6 a.m. Am I okay? Steve, am I okay? Am I misrepresenting anything? I mean, am I doing all right? The Hebrew, the Jewish night begins at 6 p.m. and runs until 6 a.m. And I guess I'm saying that roughly because, again, they didn't have atomic clocks. And the days run from 6 a.m. to 6 p.m. And so since Jesus Christ was crucified in the afternoon and placed in the tomb prior to 6 p.m., when night begins, we should start with the nights and count three nights. Can we do that? He's gone Sunday, so we can't count Sunday. So let's see. Well, let's just start Wednesday night. Let's just start there, okay? Wednesday night is the first night from 6 p.m. to 6 a.m. First night. Okay, the next night would be Thursday night, right? From 6 p.m. to 6 a.m. And then the third night would be Friday, 6 p.m. to 6 a.m. Three nights. Now we got to go days. We started with nights, so now we got to go to the day. So if we started with Wednesday night, then the first day was Thursday, right? Thursday from 6 a.m. to 6 p.m. is the first day. The second day would be Friday from 6 a.m. to 6 p.m., right? The third day would be Saturday from 6 a.m. to 6 p.m. Okay, what happens Saturday at 6 p.m.? It changes to the first day of the week, Sunday. Because that's how they do things. But he's not there when they checked on him Sunday. He's gone. Okay? Sorry. We don't have Good Friday services here. Brother Mike, we have Good Friday Wednesday. That's what we do. And I'm not trying to be a smart aleck when I do it, but I just want people to think. If we believe that the Word of God is the Word of God and without mistake, then there's no mistakes. Somebody goofed up. I don't think it was me this time. I'm saying Jesus would have come out of the grave sometime after 6 p.m. Saturday night, because then it starts Sunday, and then when they go there Sunday morning first thing, the stone is rolled away and he's already gone, right? So hallelujah for that. I'm saying he came out of the tomb sometime between 6 p.m. Saturday and 6 a.m. Sunday morning. The Sabbath that's mentioned in verse 54 wasn't the weekly Saturday Sabbath. It's a common mistake. Again, the Bible, the Word of God, explains itself, so it eliminates all the possibility of misinterpretation. All you got to do is read the Bible and know what it says. I mean, I think it was Jesus that did say, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. So if we go to the Word of God to find out the truth, then it can dispel a lot of tradition, can it? Back in John chapter 19, we're talking about the Sabbath. Look at verse 31 in John 19. The Jews, therefore, because it was the preparation that the bodies should not remain upon the cross on the Sabbath day, You see what it says in parentheses there? For that Sabbath day was an high day. It wasn't a typical weekly Sabbath, was it? It was a high Sabbath. It was a high day. For that reason, they besought Pilate, okay? In other words, it was not a regular Sabbath day. What day was it? It was the Passover. And so it was Passover. So you got two Sabbaths back to back. You got a Passover Sabbath, and you've got a weekly Sabbath, or your Saturday Sabbath, right? It's really not hard to understand, unless you remove the Word of God from the equation. Tim, how am I doing? You're just sitting there like, are you okay? Am I doing all right? Okay. I'm saying it's not a regular Sabbath day. The Sabbath was the Passover, the Sabbath of the Passover. Jesus, by the way, is our Passover, right? Our Passover lamb prepared for us. Okay, and I'm saying people that don't study their Bibles, they'll use the words of God. They don't use the words of God as their final authority. That's how traditions get started. False traditions. Jesus had something to say about that over in the book of Mark. He said, making the word of God of none effect through your tradition. People start traditions like Good Friday and Holy Saturday and whatever else, you know, whatever else they do. And they're false. They start a tradition, but that is not based on the word of God. And they do err, okay? They do err. And so Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus, they quickly went through the initial embalming procedure and placed Jesus in the tomb. And the tomb was sealed, and it remained sealed until it was open prior to Sunday morning. Okay, because they were there Sunday morning, it was already open, right? Take a look at back to Luke. Take a look at chapter 24. Hallelujah. We're getting past 23. Look at Luke 24, verse 1. The Bible says, now upon the first day of the week, very early in the morning, like 6:01, because they didn't want to violate the Sabbath, right? Well, actually, it would have already been the Sabbath. Well, the Sabbath would have been passed. Never mind, strike that one. But at the beginning of the morning there, 6 a.m. in the morning, they came unto the sepulcher bringing the spices which they had prepared. Remember verse 20 in chapter 23, the last verse said that these ladies saw how the body was being prepared, and so they prepared spices. Remember he said that? The very next chapter, in the morning of the first day of the week, they came to the sepulcher bringing those spices that they'd prepared and certain others with them. Now the they that is mentioned is Mary Magdalene and Mary the mother of James and Joseph, and you find that in the book of Matthew and Mark. And they're coming with others to finish the embalming process, okay? They're bringing new spices to continue the embalming process after the high Sabbath and after the weekly Sabbath that followed it. But none of them saw the body. Why? He's gone. He's out of there. I love this. Because the next time they did see the body, it didn't need embalming. Know why? He wasn't dead anymore. Isn't that good? I'm saying he's alive, and he's alive forevermore. And what a blessing that is. And so do you know what's going to happen to you and me when you get placed in a casket and you get lowered down into that concrete vault and then get covered with dirt? I'll tell you what's going to happen if you've placed your faith and trust in Jesus.